blessings in Jesus' name. So in this video, I just want to explain a few things. I'm sitting out here in 6 degree weather on a mat on the ground. It's probably about the same temperature as, or a little bit warmer than, you know, be the same temperature as some people's fridge at home. I've been out here in 2 degrees centigrade, which would be colder than most people's fridge. Your fridge shouldn't be that cold. And it's supposed to get colder.
Hi.
Hi.
How are you?
Well, thank you.
You don't have anywhere to stay tonight, is it?
Yeah.
Have you had anything warm to eat or drink?
No, I'm fine, thank you.
You sure?
Yeah.
Because I live close, so I can offer you tea or something.
No, thank you. I appreciate the generosity.
No worries.
Okay. Bye-bye. So, the reality of the situation is this. Somebody commented on one of my videos today. A video I made that was explaining my interactions with what's supposed to be the housing department in Wexford. I wanted to express to people how long it's been going on, my interactions with the county council. I want you to know that from a very young man, I was quite sick. I had 3 nervous breakdowns, substantial physical crashes. My nervous system crashed. And that's probably why I'm at the age of 40. I'm quite a sick man. It's not that you could diagnose me with this, that, or the other thing. It's just that my nervous system isn't strong. Now, it's not a nervous disposition or something, because I have the Spirit of the Lord in me. It's just a weakened sort of a musculoskeletal system. It's also injuries that I would have accumulated because when I was training, my nervous system was actually quite numb. So the feedback that somebody else might have gotten while they were training or working out, I wasn't getting it as sensitively. So I wouldn't have known, okay, don't push further than that, don't push that quite that far. Because of the damage I did to my nervous system as a young man, smoking marijuana. So, I had a number of crashes. The first time I had a crash, I had to kind of muscle through it, and I was working in McDonald's at the time, and I really struggled. I know McDonald's is not a difficult job, but I really struggled those days, even to just get out of the bed. So, this is when I was 16, 17. When I got to 19 again, somebody knowing that I was against marijuana brought a lump of hash into my house. And at that time I was quite low. It's probably an attack of the devil. At that time I was quite low. I'd been kind of abandoned by my friend at that time who was renting an apartment with me. You know, he got interested in a woman and that was that. So I was kind of left in the apartment on my own after that, and I ended up starting smoking marijuana again, and I had another nervous breakdown. And this nervous breakdown lasted for I would say a good 5 to 8 years. It was very difficult. So like, can you imagine like being in the prime of your life at 19 and having a nervous breakdown? So I had 2 of them at that stage. I had already had 2 nervous breakdowns by the age of 19. Then, I actually think I only had 2. I only had 2 nervous breakdowns. And they weren't like, oh, I'm a nervous wreck, da da da. It's very difficult to explain. It's like somebody presses reset and uploads somebody else. And somebody else's personality, somebody else's traits. You know, it's your nervous system isn't functioning properly. There may have been a demonic attack aspect to it as well, of course, because they're opportunistic hunters. When you're weak, they'll attack. They'll strike when you're weak. So the thing is, when I'd gone through all of these things, I just want to give you a little bit of background, and I'll get on to the council then. So I struggled a lot as a young man. Keeping a job, not because I was a lazy person, but because I was physically incapable of maintaining the pace at work because of the condition of my nervous system. And my parent, and also the difficulties I had with social interaction at that time, you would think I was a completely different person because I couldn't look a person in the eyes. Like, I went from being the life of the party to talking to everybody about anything I had confidence to a complete crash and not being able to look somebody in the eye. So, can you imagine that, you know, you're 19 years of age, you're only coming into your singing voice, realizing that you really do have quite a good quality voice yourself, and that you could even make a career out of it, and then a nervous breakdown. And it was like somebody just stole my voice from me. They just took it away, they just swiped it away. I couldn't sing. I didn't know how to sing anymore. Because that whatever happened to my nervous system, it was like somebody just wiped it away from me. It just wiped the ability to sing naturally away from me. And I just couldn't. I couldn't remember the words of songs. I couldn't focus long enough on something. And then I would dwell on things that I shouldn't be dwelling on. And so my mind was just all over the place. And so this was from smoking marijuana. Then what happened was, because of the difficulties I had with getting a job and then keeping a job and interacting with people, you know, people can kind of think you're sort of an oddball because you're so quiet. And then, you know, realistically, probably I avoided a lot of harm because of that. But I also tended to get in with the wrong types of people. Not that I would judge anybody with finality, but just to say that at the time they weren't doing the things that I should have sought to do. The problem is when you're not really kind of in the clique at home in your family house, as human beings, we tend to look for groupings and acceptance elsewhere. We tend to go to other groups of people because we want that acceptance. We want to have a piece of that sort of security in a group and to grow in a group and relate to people and have friends, you know. And so I went away from my family unit, realizing that I didn't really get on with anybody. I was sort of, I came along at a time where my two older brothers were sort of grown up and doing their own thing. And then my sister was, of course, a girl. She was doing her own thing. And then my youngest sister was 11 years younger. So I didn't really fit into my family. And they were also busy doing what they were doing. And I had fallen into drugs, trying to escape probably the isolation and the loneliness of just being in that place in the family, you know. But it ended up having a worse effect on me. So in my young life, I sort of lost my youth. I sort of completely lost my youth because of attacks of the devil. The devil leads us into things. Now, we make decisions. There's no refuting that. There's no getting around that. We make decisions. But the devil is trying to set you up all the way along. And he's looking for opportunities to isolate people who have been abandoned by their families. In many ways, that was the case with me. Whether it was an intentional thing or whether it was unintentional, it happened. And so I think then I fell into groups that, you know, these people were, they weren't really interested in me as a person. And I was so sort of introspective at that time because I was sort of stuck in a mind prison. It was like I was a prisoner in my own body because my body wasn't functioning how it should at that age. And I had really, my nervous system had really kind of crashed. And God knows the damage that was done to the neurology of my brain and the synapses at that time. So the reality for me was quite difficult as a young person. I fell into solvent abuse very young in life. I was probably about 9 when I started smoking. Not long after I started drinking whiskey. Then after that I started sucking out of gas cans because that's what all the other boys were doing. And then I started smoking drugs because that's what the boys were doing behind the changing rooms, dressing rooms at the back of the school. And I got into that and then I took to that because it sort of gave me that escape and that out. And I used to go away and just smoke marijuana in the hedges on my own and just spend hours there just sitting on my own. And just escaping this world, because I knew something was wrong with it. And myself, I knew there was something wrong with it. I knew I wasn't fitting in, and I was trying to escape. And so I ended up harming myself in trying to escape. And so again, I'll tell you, I had that nervous breakdown when I was about 16. And because I had been in my formative years, well, the brain neurology was being set down, damaged myself, and very physically damaged myself in the physiology of my brain. And it took many, many years through the neuroplasticity and the ability of the brain to heal itself, which is called neuroplasticity, for the brain to start functioning very well again. Now, at no stage was I sort of very bad, but at some stages I was even struggling to speak. I was slurring my speech and all sorts of things. I really, really struggled. It was like I sort of had a stroke, but not a stroke. It's very difficult to explain. And some days it was like there was a hippopotamus sitting on me and I just couldn't get out of the bed. And all I wanted to do was just engage society, speak with people, be able to work, be able to do the things I did before. But I had just so badly damaged myself from drug use that I really was just a shell of a person. And I'd lost so much weight. When I was 19, I was working out, you know, I started lifting weights and I started getting strong, I started getting fit, I started filling out. And when I was 19, 20, then I had that second nervous breakdown and just all that muscle mass fell away. It was like my musculoskeletal system and wasn't getting that impulse, it wasn't getting that injection of sort of nervous energy that it needed to function, you know, properly. And it was just really difficult again. And I lost my appetite, couldn't eat, couldn't stomach things. And then I was working at McDonald's, I was only eating McDonald's food, and that made me sicker over time. And I was just really bad. I was having panic attacks, and I was having moments of euphoria, which is sort of a psychosis symptom. So guys, don't take smoking marijuana lightly. And if you wonder why I won't go over to Osnam House now and sit in rooms where they're smoking marijuana, right? If you're wondering why I won't go into those places where they're smoking marijuana like it's a nightclub in Jamaica or something, well, now you know. Now you know. Marijuana is the devil's drug. People think, oh, it's only a bit of hash. What's the problem with it? No, it is a drug from Satan. It is one of the most insidious, slow-creeping drugs that will take your life away from you. It will steal you of yourself. It is horrible. It's very, very highly evil. Take it from me. Stay away from it. It's disgusting. And they're trying to legalize it. They're trying to start with CBD oil. Now you have these basically hostels where people can go and smoke their brains out, mop a floor and get an extra 20 quid to buy more hash, get their meals, and it's like a prison outside of a prison where they get to smoke hash. Sure, they've got everything they want. Music, TV, computer games, couches, room of their own, crack, cocaine, marijuana. Why would they go anywhere else? And then people who, like myself, who want to stay away from drugs, who want to get back into the society, who want to stay healthy, who want to have a fit and healthy body, how can we stay fit and healthy or heal our injuries lying on the mat on the ground? How do you think that can work? How do you think you can get fit and healthy and recover dragging a bag around with you that weighs whatever it weighs, 10 kilos all day long? These people aren't stupid. They know what they're putting us through. They know that. So when somebody comes on and they say, You told the council never to contact you again, you're a liar. No, at no stage did I say that I didn't say that to the council. I did tell the council not to contact me again. After more than 10 years of them messing me around and not giving me the help they should have. Because I was a very unwell man. I was a sick man. And I still managed to have somewhat of a career in chefing. And I still managed to have a career in music. For 8 years, I still served my community. I still contributed to the society. I still entertained people, played music at their wedding. I fed them. And what did they do to me? The first sign of adversity, they just jump you through hoops. They don't help you when you need their help. They make life more difficult for you. And then people wonder why you would turn around and say, don't contact me again, when all they've been is a hindrance to you. Apart from one occasion where they helped me with housing assistance payments for a few months because I lost my work at music, because I left Freemasonry after being duped into believing it was something it wasn't, after becoming a Master Mason, when I realized it was Satan worship and service of the devil himself and demons, I left it. And then they attacked me further. I was told, you've only a certain amount of time to get out of the house, we're selling it. I tried to look for other houses. None of them were habitable for a little girl, because I had my little girl with me at that time, 3 days a week. Like places over a pub or this, that and the other place wasn't suitable. And so I also had to sell my car around that time because I couldn't afford to keep it because the work had gone away. And, you know, I was looking for a place in town for me and my little girl where I wouldn't need a car. And couldn't find anything. I ended up sleeping in a tent. And what did the council do for me then? What did they do for me then? I was reaching out to them then. I was asking them for help. What did they do for me? And then they keep taking me off the housing list for the last 10 to 15 years. They're putting me on the housing list, taking me back off it, not telling me that they took me off it. Then I go back in, I reapply, they put me back on it. Then they take me off of it for another reason. And the most recent reason was the straw that broke the camel's back. I was renting a room at 72 King Street. And it was costing me €90 a week, all bills included. It wasn't bad compared to what's around. But when you're on €208, paying €35 maintenance, €90 rent, and you have a ministry to uphold, and you have food to put in your belly, clothes to put on your back, and all of that stuff to take care of, €90 just doesn't, €208 a week just doesn't cut it. I approached the council. I told them, I need your help. I need housing assistance payment. 2 years I was trying to survive paying only €208. Somebody might say, well, you did it for 2 years. I was going without food. I had the same coat and the same clothes for that period of time. The same clothes. One pair or two pairs of clothes. The only thing I would buy every so often was new underwear and socks when there were holes in them. But apart from that, I had the same stuff for 2 years. And what happened then? I had to make the decision to move out because they told me, because you don't have a lease agreement, we're not giving you housing assistance payment, even though the tenancy agreement I had was perfectly lawful. Now, the next time somebody comes to the video and says, you told the council not to contact you, you're a liar, I'm openly telling you, yes, I have told the council not to contact me because of all of the aforementioned. But all of that stuff happened first. The straw that broke the camel's back was they said, they sent me a letter asking me for proof of my address. How did they know where to send the letter? And why then would they require proof of address if they already knew my address to send me the letter? Then they took me off the housing list because I didn't get back to them in a timely fashion. And after they sent me out a letter and said, you might lose your place on the housing list, I called them on the phone. They said, right, that's fine. Everything's sorted now. You needn't worry. And they took me off the housing list anyway. So what's the point in trying to deal with people like that? Then I went back in. They put me and my daughter back on the housing list. Do you know what they said? This is when I'm homeless now. We only have Osnam House to offer you. I said, I have special dietary needs. I can't eat the food there. And they've told me that I have to pay the €80 regardless of whether I can eat that food or not. Now, before I left the place, they did suggest that I go to the place, and but this was only a suggestion, there was nothing confirmed at this stage. What if, they said, you could go there and pay less because you're not eating there? What if? But then I wouldn't have the cooking facilities to make my own potatoes, because I need to cook my own roots. I need to have a facility to cook my own food, so that my digestive system is under control and I stay regular and I stay healthy enough. So I made them aware of all of this stuff, and they wouldn't accommodate me the first time, and the second time it wasn't confirmed. Then I spent one night in the crash bed room there, and it was like a house party in Jamaica. I said, I can't come here and stay here and be exposed to this on a daily basis. When I left that hostel, I was stoned. I was under the influence of marijuana. I was intoxicated because of the amount of drugs being smoked there. The next day I was groggy. Can you imagine trying to live there? Day in, day out? When they're using it like a party house? So guys, next time, think. Does somebody enjoy sleeping on a mat on the ground rather than in a bed in a warm place with the facility to cook and shower? It's obviously a last resort, because everything else has been denied that person. So have a think. Next time you jump to a conclusion, think, people aren't stupid. They're not stupid. I'm not here because I'm stupid. I didn't tell the council not to contact me again because they were so helpful the first time. They had become a disturbance in my life. They'd become an interference, actually. They'd become a source of problems. They're supposed to be the ones who solve the problems, not the ones who create them. When they become the ones who create the problems, it's time to tell them not to contact you. They utterly failed in their duties to me and my daughter. Utterly. Blessings.